and welcome to the CFC Talk podcast. This is now episode 47, and we're going to be covering the snooze fest of this Barnsley game that we've just, I know it's been a couple of days now at least since we've played the game. But yeah, I'm going to be joined by my usual co-host Amart and Mohammed, who might be in. He's kind of shifting between different dimensions at the moment. His internet's a little he's shifting between dimensions. You might hear from him at some point, but if you're lucky. But for the most part, it'll be me and Amart. So before we get into the game and look at the bonds of the game, just wanted a quick note on, so our past couple of videos have been doing extremely well. We've had, I think we're getting a couple of hundred views on each of our podcasts, but it seems like around 75% of you aren't subscribed, and we're getting a couple of likes, but what we'd really appreciate is if you just take the time to scroll down and give us a like, just to show some of the appreciation for the work, the huge amount of work that goes into making these. So yeah, we'd really appreciate it if you gave us a like or even a subscribe if you want to hear a bit more from us. But let's get into the Barnsley game. But yeah, the title of this pod will probably be sending us to Barnsleep. And that's pretty much what it did, Amart, don't you think? It was quite a boring one, I have to say. And would you agree with that?
Yeah, it was a boring one. Barnsley didn't come out to joke at all. Like they really came out to win the game, and you could see that it was very, very intense. I'm not even sure. I wanted to check at first whether it was the same manager that they had when we beat them 6-0. I'm not sure whether it's the same manager or not, but even if it is, then he has really, really improved, because this team didn't look like the team that we beat 6-0 at all. They came out better. They came out more determined, more motivated to even win the game. I think throughout the game, at the end of the 90 minutes, they were the better team by far. And we took our chance. We took the only chance that we got. That's one shot on target, and we scored. So that we still got the result, but yeah, definitely a boring game.
It was quite interesting because I think I found out after the game. So Barnsley, they put a tweet out. So weirdly, firstly, Barnsley had their account suspended on the day of the game on Twitter for some reason. And then they posted a picture with like a love heart emoji. And it was a picture of them rolling the grass. Cutting the grass on their stadium, making it look like it was in pristine condition. But it was quite funny because the side of the pitch that's closer to the camera, that we saw the game through, that side of the pitch was out of view of this nice picture they took. And in the game, especially on that side, it was just awful. I got to say, the pitch in general, it definitely didn't make it any easier for us, did it? I guess, aside from half the team not playing that well. But do you think a poor pitch levels it out a bit between teams that are in different leagues?
I think, in my opinion, it shouldn't affect a lot. I mean, yes, it's going to affect the better teams. And of course, a team like Barnsley, you're probably just used to playing pitches like this. And I guess Chelsea are so used to playing in world-class pitches in world-class stadiums in the Premier League that they would have probably struggled. And I guess as the game progresses, you just kind of get used to it. You just kind of have that mindset of you've got to play on this pitch and there's nothing you can do about it. So, the picture was kind of deceiving because that pitch looked immaculate and the pitch that they played on was almost the opposite. But at the end, yeah, it does play a factor. And of course, it is hard to play on a pitch which is not perfect, especially for a team who's inexperienced in that kind of area. But it shouldn't affect it as much. Whereas you go from winning 6-0 and to barely winning 1-0. And as Amart said, yeah, hats off to their coach for the improvement on the team, because at times it almost looked like this was going to be an FA Cup upset for us. So yeah, I think very close game, and you've got to blame some of our players as well for their performance that was up there. So you can't just solely blame the pitch or their performance.
Yeah, I just want to add that I was also getting a very, very worried getting to the end before we even got the goal, because we haven't beat them in the FA Cup. We've met them twice in the FA Cup previously, and they've beaten us twice. So they have a 100% record against us in the FA Cup before we even met them. So they didn't want to let go of that record. I think that was probably what motivated them even more. They wanted to beat us a third time in the FA Cup, and they at a point they looked like they were going to upset us, like Mohammed said, but we grinded out the results, and then we qualified for the next round.
That is some very interesting information. I did not know that they'd beaten us twice in the FA Cup previously to make it three times. That's really interesting, considering, I guess, they are, I mean, what, still mid-table championship, and they've done it twice. It's quite interesting. But yeah, it was really weird. Like, you could see there was a real difference in the way, I mean, we didn't see it much in the League Cup game last year, but they played in the back five pretty much, and they really pressed, like, they pressed really high up for a championship team against a Premier League team. That's quite ballsy to say, and brave. Like, they literally, every time they won the ball, that just five of their defenders in line would all just march up to the halfway line, and they really pressed us. So it was quite an interesting. I definitely think it felt like the team kind of underestimated them in a way. We didn't really expect them to be this kind of imposing on our team. But aside from that as well, the only last comment on their team, at least, was I'd like to give a little shout out to Connor Chaplin, who is a FIFA 17 Portsmouth career mode legend, in my opinion. And sorry, off topic, but Connor Chaplin is absolutely overpowered on FIFA, and it's become but he didn't really score today. He got one shot off, so it's let's bury that one where it is. But getting into our performance, at least, I mean, earlier in the first half, sorry, that was a little appreciation for a man who's given me a lot of joy on FIFA.
You lost me when you started talking about FIFA, because I'm a PES man. Ooh. I don't like FIFA. I've always played PES, so mainly you say FIFA, like, my mind just goes into off mode.
Denial mode.
Yeah.
I'm sure his card isn't that bad on PES either. Well, no, he's very pacey. Well, at least I don't think his card is bad,
but I'll check it and see. I don't think it is.
Yeah. FIFA 17, FIFA 18, just as a side note, Portsmouth were so Connor Chaplin used to play their left wing of Hudson-Odoi last night, used to play for Portsmouth, and Portsmouth on FIFA 2018 onwards are ridiculously overpowered for some reason. Like, they have just a ridiculous number of pacey players, and Connor Chaplin was just godly. I won the Champions League with Portsmouth because of Connor Chaplin. So it's just a side note. But getting on to our team, I mean, first half, they definitely, I mean, what, they had more shots in the game. First half, they put a cross in, and Kepa had to make a really good reaction save. Yes, the ball was coming to him. The ball was pretty much shot straight at him, but it was a good reaction save nonetheless. And do you guys think, I mean, I thought in the game, yes, Kepa made some good saves, but there were still some signs that he's not a very commanding keeper, and do you think it's still, like, this doesn't change anything really, even though he got the clean sheet, that Mendy's still number one until we perhaps maybe get someone better in the future season or summers, but you don't think there's any chance of Kepa doing anything, as in making any changes to the order of goalkeepers at the club at the moment?
I think, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I'll let his number one fan talk about him first.
Okay, great.
According to you both, I give a lot of stick to Kepa, and as Alex likes to say, he's my favorite player at Chelsea. I think he deserves credit for the way he played against Barnsley. There were a few nervy moments. There were a few moments where he could have done better, but there were moments where he did incredible. And I think, as you said, the reaction save, even if it was just because he was in the way and it was kind of off, kind of just a lucky save, it kept us in the game, because eventually if they scored that, they would have probably sat back, or they would have, defended their hearts out for that win. So honestly, that one, and then plus I think there was one where Tammy helped him out a bit, and one another save, which I can't exactly remember what it was, but there was one more. So yeah, he did play well, but according to the order, I don't see a £71 million goalkeeper becoming a backup option for Mendy, because realistically, Caballero is probably going to retire next season or the season after. So yeah, we might have to, and again, it doesn't seem like Kepa's going to be the first choice, so it's got to be Mendy for me first choice, but it doesn't seem right to have a £71 million goalkeeper as a backup, so we might have to give him out on loan, send him out on loan, or sell him and get as much as we can from him. And I guess I will say one thing, I've seen him try a lot, and he's been through a lot at Chelsea. I think after that first season, he just hasn't been the same Kepa. But yeah, I think it's either a loan or a new club for Kepa, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's fair enough. I mean, it's unless something bad happens to Mendy, I don't see him getting to probably test get another chance in the Premier League, at least for a bit of time, or probably forever unless he, like I said. But I mean, other than that, for good performances, Tammy for sure. He definitely looked. I mean, of the front three, we'll probably get into the wingers in a little bit, but Tammy definitely looked quite sharp in this one. Do you guys agree?
I might go for it.
Yeah, he was. He was very, very sharp. He was one of the best players. I think he was our best player on the pitch, and he was doing so much. He was defending. He was winning possession. He was creating chances for himself. I think something we all know that when it's critical, he can defend. He does very well when we're on the back foot and we need someone tall to defend corners. And he did. I think he cleared a chance at the end for us, and that was very, very good. Like a goal line clearance or something. He headed the ball over the goalpost, and it denied them getting a chance to equalize. And yeah, I think yesterday I saw something on him that we've always wanted him to do, but he really doesn't do. Last season, I think one of his main problems was that he usually waits for the last ball. He usually waits for the attacking midfielders to find him, and then he'll get a chance and score. But yesterday he wasn't really waiting. He was coming in to receive the passes, like what Giroud does that we always love about him. Tammy was actually coming in to find to receive the balls himself, to regain possession and then create chances for himself. And yesterday he even had a chance. He nearly had a penalty call. And I think if it wasn't for the VAR wasn't available, so we didn't get a penalty. But if VAR was available, we would have gotten the penalty from that chance. So yeah. Yesterday he did very, very well. He did very well. And the goal, he took the goal very well. I think Reese also did very well. It started from Gilmore to Reese, then Reese to Tammy. It was an academy goal, and I was happy about that. He took the goal very well. We got only one chance in the game and we scored. And that was good. That was very, very good.
It was quite funny to see that I think as the game started, the commentators said, "Oh, there's no VAR in this game. We'll finally be able to just trust the officials." And then by the end of the game, Chelsea should have had a penalty, might have had an offside goal, which in hindsight proved to be onside. And I think I think there was another VAR call that was wrong somewhere. I think, or no, a referee call that was wrong. So it just shows that there'll be complaints either ways, and there'll be wrongness either way. There'll be wrong decisions either way. So it was a funny one. But also, I mean, looking to the side of Abraham, Pulisic and Ziyech, just, I mean, maybe we could put it a bit down to the pitch, but it's also definitely down to either of them just not really playing well at the moment. Mohammed, do you think that, like, how are we going to get these guys firing again? Because Pulisic's not scored this season in the Premier League, I don't think. And Ziyech has had only a couple of really good games for Chelsea in the past month, a couple of months, so, or probably since our season. So, yeah, how are we going to get these guys in form again, or what do we got to do?
Honestly, okay, so I think with Pulisic, it's the case of injury. I think with both players, it's a case of injuries. They've both been unfortunate to be injured for quite a while, you know, this season. And as we're seeing with Timo Werner, these both are not as confident as they would have been. And it's not just about scoring goals with Pulisic and Ziyech. These are key players in building up our attacks, and we know the capabilities that Ziyech has of switching plays and just, you know, taking the ball from point A to point B without any trouble. And I guess it's just about confidence. And under Tuchel, both of them haven't had a lot of game time. And, you know, the FA Cup was really their first glimpse of under Tuchel. So I would hope that, you know, he does back them up. He does make sure that they get their chances. And I guess as they play on and hopefully they'll regain their confidence, you know, we kind of saw this burst from Pulisic towards the end of the season last time after what we like to call Project Restart Pulisic. And I'm hoping that without a Project Restart this season, he can still go off at the end of the season. There's still a long way to go. Especially with the tough games that we're going to have and with the frequency that we're going to have games from at the end of February. So there's going to be a lot of chances for them to come on there and make their mark, in my opinion. And I forgot what the other part was, that question, or is that it?
I think that was it. It was just on Ziyech and Pulisic, just what to do, how, and yeah. They have been pretty unlucky with injuries, but it begs the question. I guess we'll maybe get into it later. But Amart, do you think we should be content with these guys? I mean, there have been some fans at least calling on Twitter for that they'd take it, Sancho or Grealish or another winger to compete with these guys. And which do you think that's something like that is necessary, or are you happy with the wingers? And do you think that they'll be able to get out of their back of form eventually?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely, these are not. We've seen the best of these players, and like Mohammed said, it's just injuries that have kept them from performing to their best. But Pulisic, I think, more than Ziyech. Ziyech is also recovering from injury, but he's also trying to figure out what his place is in the team as well. But with Pulisic, I think it's more of a mental thing, because he was usually coming in and going out of the squad due to injuries, and you can tell that he doesn't want to even commit himself fully to certain chances when he's playing, because probably he's afraid he might get another injury and then go out again. So that's where the problem is. But I think when he regains that back, when he regains that confidence and he's fully fit, we'll see the best of him. It's a bit worrying that he hasn't scored a goal in any competition this season, which is very, very worrying. But we know how Pulisic is. We know how good he is. When he turns up, even in games that he doesn't score, you can see that he's been doing well in them. But in the Barnsley game, especially in the Barnsley game, he was a bit lost. I think Ziyech was way better than him in the Barnsley game. He was a bit lost in the game. Even when he came off, I was even surprised he was still on, because I thought he had gone off already, and because I wasn't really seeing much from him. So, but I'm very confident he'll pick up. I don't think we need players to come in and they already have competition as it is. We have so many players in certain positions that are already competing with each other. We don't need players to come from other teams. Grealish and I don't think we need them to make them better. They'll come good. This season has been a weird one. Like last time, I was just thinking about it and thinking about what striker or what attacking player came in during the summer transfer? Who came in during the summer transfer? Like, which one of them have really taken off in the season? And I don't know, I think apart from even Cavani, that it hasn't been doing well. Rodriguez, probably. Thiago Alcantara, nah. Like, you can see that, like, the season hasn't been normal. Like, those players haven't really taken off. I think those who have taken off are the defenders. The defenders and the goalkeepers have done very, very well. But the attackers haven't really had their best games in the Premier League, probably due to the fact that they didn't have a preseason. Nobody had a preseason or something. But I think next season we'll see the best of all these players, especially the attackers that Chelsea got. We'll see the best of them next season. But this season, it will take some time.
Yeah, I agree. Like, it's a really good point you made, that I can't think of any strikers that have, or even attacking players, that have really taken off for their team. Like, I was thinking maybe Diogo Jota, but...
Yeah, he was already in the Premier League before.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think with him, he was already used to the Premier League, and he already knew how the Premier League was. So, yeah, I also thought about him as well, but I think because he was already in it. And Watkins, came.
But also from the Championship. Yeah, he was also in the Championship. Yeah.
He was already in England and stuff like that. But I've not really seen anybody else who came from outside of England and has really taken off. So I think you just have to be patient with all of them.
Yeah, I do hope even for ZX, especially for ZX case, we see more of the champ. I mean, to be fair, some people have said he's only had a couple of good games for Chelsea, but the way I see it, the way I remember at least, every time he's in the Champions League, particularly, he always shows up. It's some, I don't know, I remember in the Ren game, I think, where Giroud got the clutch winner, and it was from a ZX free kick who had come on as a sub. I just remember Ziyech playing really well in the Champions League usually. So when Atletico comes around, even if he's not playing in fantastic form, by the time it comes around, I would probably play him, because he seems like a different player sometimes when he's in the Champions League. But looking a bit further back to the left, at least, seeing Alonso and Emerson both starting, which, given both players' defensive frailties have kind of been exposed this season and last, but was that a bit of a surprise to you to see? And do you think either of them played particularly well, or because I didn't really see anything from either of them. And it was good to see Alonso taken off at half time for James, I think, and Rudiger. I think it was James and Rudiger, I think, or was that?
Yeah, it was James and Rudiger.
But did Alonso come off at half time?
And he came off. Yeah. He came off for James, and then Rudiger came on Christensen. Yeah.
And James looked much, much better. I mean, I didn't see anything from Alonso today, but it must have been. It was quite weird to see him at some points centre back, don't you think?
Sorry, yeah.
Mohammed?
No, I was just I kind of scrolled down on Zencaster and I saw this comment. I think Alonso and Emerson was a weird start, to be honest. I think we were expecting Emerson to get a start. He hasn't had much time against Tuchel, but I guess he kind of wanted to give both of them a start. But I think that just caused both of them to not play well as they would have probably played as left wing back. And I'd go as far as to say Alonso is someone who can only play left wing back. So having him at left back is scary. Imagine having him at centre back, which is even scarier. So, and I think the Kepa reaction, say, was because Alonso was caught sleeping and not looking at the ball. But I think if we're going to play one of them, it's going to have to be Alonso, and it's going to have to be left wing back. There's no reason to play both of them at the same time. And I think when Rudiger and James came on, as you said, James played really well, in my opinion, as well. Rudiger did his job as well. So I think it was weird seeing that combination. But and Emerson, I think left wing back played. I didn't see much of him, and he didn't really have much of influence in trying to get a goal or trying to build up attacks. So overall, the starting defense wasn't as good as the second half defense when we brought on Rudiger and Reece James.
Yeah, it was really, they especially first half, just didn't really see. I mean, whenever we have Alonso, Emerson, and Christensen all in, it's just a bit of a not a recipe for disaster because it's Burnley Barnsley, but
I mean, not, I'm not gonna say that stat from Amart.
But Amart, do you have anything to add to the left wing back debate? Or
it was definitely weird to see Alonso and Emerson start, and I think that's the first time they've both started in the game for Chelsea. It was weird, but I think Emerson was the better player out of the two, because Alonso was most of the times completely lost, and I don't really blame him, but I think the physicality of the Barnsley players and the aggressive nature of their play kind of put him off a bit, and that's the thing with Alonso. But Emerson did very well as part of the three defenders. But left wing back, definitely will pick Alonso every time ahead of Emerson. Even though Emerson has been given as good performances this season so far, he has been doing well. But yeah, Alonso had to come off. And when he came off, you could tell Rhys was way better than him. And Rhys even assisted a goal in the end. And even in the beginning, Alonso nearly gave away a goal because he completely missed his man. And then the striker got, I think it was a tap-in or so. At school, but Kepa did very, very well and saved and cleared that chance. So yeah, it was good. It was good that he went off. And I think yesterday, I don't want to do comparisons. I really don't want to keep bringing up Lampard or anything. But when I was watching the game, it just dawned on me that unlike probably Lampard would have taken time to make those substitutions at halftime, he would have waited and given the team. And I think he was more considerate on that part. Like, he would allow the team, even though the team does bad in the first half, he will allow them to go there and try and redeem themselves before he takes somebody off. But I think with Tuchel, he doesn't really have that kind of time to be testing things out when he sees what is going wrong. And because there's a lot of pressure on him, especially with the sacking of Lampard, he has to do well. So when he sees what's going wrong on the first and the just a second half or half time, he would just make the changes straight away, and it helped a bit. They were still aggressive. Barnsley were still attacking us and worrying us, but our defense was solid. We did very well. Rudiger did very well against Barnsley as well. So, I mean, we got our goal, we defended it, and that was that.
In all fairness, there was 5 subs available in the game, so I guess you can afford to make subs earlier as well and still have the luxury later. But yeah, I do definitely get what you mean. Lampard would barely ever make half-time substitutions unless, I think Marcus Alonso was the one that comes to mind against West Brom with his kind of nightmare performance where he got taken off half-time. But I mean, you can't really say that, I mean, in this game, that Christensen and Alonso played that badly. It's just we needed some more urgency, so we got, and perhaps some physicality as well. Christensen, it was interesting to see in the first half, Christensen had one of his trademark knocks where he got, to be fair, feel sorry for the guy, he did get a heel to the head and stayed down, and they got a chance and took a shot. But yeah, it's just weird to see. Like, I'm in mixed minds about it, and I don't know if you guys are too. Like,
I think he went down before he got the heel to the head. He went down first and was trying. He tried to grab the Barnsley player's leg, and I think he missed it. And then in the wake of them attacking, I think one of them hit his head or something like that, and he was down. But it just left space at the back now, and they took. I think they even took a shot, right? But it was on the side netting or something like that.
It was weird because I think there was another tackle in the game where he did attempted tackle where he kind of fell to the floor, and then just the guy is dribbling past him and he literally tries to head tackle the ball of it.
That's what I was talking about.
It's like, what? This is mental. Yeah. This guy is, considering this guy is like quite fragile a defender, for him to be doing that, I was like, man, this guy's going to be out with a head injury for like years if that goes bad. So if any of the defenders were going to try that, I wouldn't expect it to be Christensen.
Maybe he'll have to walk out with one of the caps.
Yeah, that check honestly, to be fair, even normal player, if that goes wrong, you'd probably end up in one of those caps for it, because that can go wrong quite easily. But
yeah,
looking at, I mean, other parts of the team, Gilmore, good to see Gilmore and Kante come back in. Personally, I didn't think it was that they were that great, but it was a weird one because, yes, they pressed up really high, and I mean, you didn't really see much chemistry between Gilmore and Kante, and they still had some good-ish moments, especially Gilmore, I think, had a couple, I mean, combined well with James good pass to James to get the goal. But yeah, I didn't really see much from Gilmore and Kante, if I'm honest. What did you guys think of it? Did you think they were all right? Or yeah, it was weird to see for me.
I think for me, Gilmore was a tricky one because I think, isn't it his first start under Tuchel?
Yeah, I think yeah. So.
So I think Gilmore, I wouldn't write him off right away and say he doesn't fit the system because it's his first start, so he might just need a few games to get into it and just understand the change from 4-3-3 to a 3-4-4, whatever we play up top, depending on the game. I think Kante, yeah, again, as you said, they weren't very good at what they do, and I think this is where we kind of realize how important Jorginho and Kovacic are in this formation, because what a lot of people call them dead wood, and essentially they've now become our first choice midfielders. But it's nice to see us get options. I mean, yes, Kante is one of the best, or was one of the best defensive midfielders. And it's great to see someone like Billy Gilmore get a chance as well. And hopefully we see more of them throughout the season. And then hopefully they put up performances where they can compete with Jorginho and Kovacic.
Yeah, I know they weren't really the best, but I'll have to agree them disagree with you guys. I think Kante and Gilmore worked very well. I think the whole thing was that the pressure from Barnsley was like so immense that like the whole team was just finding it difficult to control them or to put them under control, because I felt like Kante was controlling most of that midfield. That midfield, like, it was him. He was everywhere in that midfield, and Gilmore was also doing the simple things. Like, we really didn't really see anything extra from them, like feeding the attackers or like trying to create chances. But they were in charge of that midfield. If you notice, like, most of the chances Barnsley were having, they were coming from the wings. They weren't really using the middle that often. But I don't know. I just think they had a good game. Even though the whole thing was a bit boring, they had a good game, but we didn't really have any threats in attack. But in defense, I think we're very solid. We're very, very solid in defense. And I think that was partly thanks to Kante and Gilmore also stopping any form of attack that came into, before it even reached the defenders. They did very well in that aspect. But in attack, that's where I think they fell short, because they weren't really finding the pockets and the spaces in defense and stuff like that. That's why I said Tammy had to come in to create chances for himself most of the time. Same in Pulisic. They were the ones kind of doing that kind of job. They were Gilmore and Kante weren't doing that. So yeah, for me, their combination was good, but yeah, I think the way the whole game went and the way the whole game was, we didn't really attack that much to be able to give them like an excellent kind of performance. They were okay.
14 shots on our goal and 4 on target. Would that indicate much of a solidity or not?
I think a lot of that has to do with, sorry, Mark, to interrupt, but I think a lot of that has to do with Thiago Silva not being in defense. We've seen the difference he can do in the defense. And again, as we said, starting with Emerson and Alonso was not the best of choices by Tuchel.
Yeah, it's true, but yeah, they didn't have Thiago. They didn't have all three of our defenders, man for man, were better than theirs, and we shouldn't need Thiago Silva to be solid against Barnsley, to me. But Mark, what are you going to say? Yeah,
yeah, but I don't think we expected Barnsley to play like that. I don't even think the team expected Barnsley to play like that. I think they thought they were going to go there and get I would not say an easy win, but I don't think they expected Barnsley to come out or they come all out like the way they did, because Barnsley came to win. They didn't come to joke around. They came to win, and they nearly got an equalizer at the end. If it wasn't for Tammy clearing that chance away, and he did, I think they had chances to score, but I think they messed up some of their chances to score, and especially in the first half with that chance that Kepa saved. They almost got an early goal from that. So I think it's that the team didn't really expect them to play like that. So. But they adjusted well. Tuchel made the right substitutions, and we adjusted well, and we matched up to them. I think getting to the end of the game, after we scored the goal, we just locked down and started defending. So I think that was good. That was good to see. But we just got off. We just got the points. So I don't really know. We'll take that. It was a boring game, but we'll take the win any day.
Yeah, especially in the latter half, like in the last 10 minutes of the game, they had six shots and three on target, so they definitely cranked it up at the end. But it was nice to see that we rode it out, and although it was a little bit, biting of the nails, because there was that one with Tammy, excellent block from Tammy. Really, like that was going that header, I think, from the Barnsley players going top corner. And for Tammy to get ahead on that was amazing. I remember the last part of the game was just seeing more of Kepa's lack of controlling in the box. It was quite fun. I mean, I think Chelsea posted a thing on Instagram of Kepa commanding his box, which is very ironic because I think it was the only time where he actually caught the cross or caught the corner. They posted that, but there were so many ones where he punched or just it looked very it looked really risky.
There were so many that he completely missed, and I think thanks to the defenders they got it under control.
Yeah, indeed. Right, I think that kind of sums up everything for Barnsley. Before we moved on, for two things. Firstly, anything else that we'd want to talk about?
I think I'm just surprised we managed to do 37 minutes of Barnsley.
Yeah, anything for our viewers, anything. We'll go. Yeah, it's impossible. If it's not going to CFC talk, if it's not at least an hour, so
I think Alex is half asleep already.
Nah, Newcastle
might wake you up.
Yep, I'm definitely gonna be awake for Newcastle. And before we get into the Newcastle. Into the Newcastle, sound like Tuchel saying the Wolves. No, but no. Before we get into the Newcastle, centre back choices and centre back transfers has kind of come up over the past couple of days, with names like Upamecano being confirmed to being transferred to Bayern Munich, and so it's kind of set up the discussion of. Who do Chelsea go for? It's been widely reported that we're going to go for a centre-back in the summer. And there's lots of names thrown around, like Varane, Nicolas Sula, Ibrahima Konate. I think that's, Konate, who's Upamecano's teammate at Leipzig. But guys, do you guys have a preference? Or just hoping that we can get someone similar to Thiago Silva's stature into the team?
I think if whoever we get, if they perform like Zuma has throughout the season, if someone performs the same way as Zuma or Thiago Silva, it works for Chelsea. But I'd like to say one thing, and I think Christensen playing centrally has been good for Chelsea in this back three. And there seems to be a potential in there. And it will be interesting how that pans out throughout the season. And if that works, then we kind of have these three options with Zuma, Silva, and Christensen. And then if we bring in one more as backup, it would have been perfect. Obviously, then we'd have to sell Rudiger and some other players. But I'll be honest, I haven't really kept tabs with a lot of transfer news in the past weeks, because I think it's a bit too soon to look at transfer news, in my opinion. because there's still almost half the season remaining and anything can happen. And but I do know that Chelsea are looking for a striker and a defender, so I'll leave it up to you both for this discussion because I have zero knowledge of the defenders that you mentioned.
Man, Mohammed's setting me up. He gave me gave me a cue of centre back transfer discussions for this podcast, and now he's just shut it down himself. What a man! He does what he wants on this podcast. He does what he wants. But Amart, anything to add? Or
I got to make the hosting interesting for you.
I'll bear in mind this for future if he wants to throw me off at some point. But Amart, anything to add to the centre back debate, or something we can more talk about in the summer?
Yeah, I think, to be honest, I just want Tomori to come back because he's been doing well for AC Milan. Yeah, Tomori needs to come back. Magehito has been doing very, very well in the championship this season. So we have options that can just come in and play in that position. I don't know why we have to go and buy new center backs. We have to offload one of Rudiger or Christensen, or both of them if it's possible. One of them, I'm sure one of them will go during the summer. Probably might not be Rudiger because it looks like Tuchel loves him, but probably Christensen might be the one to go. If we don't get anybody in, they might stay, but I want to see Tomori back because he's doing very well. He's been doing very well against AC Milan. He hasn't played much, but he has been doing well. But Magehi is the one that I'm really, really looking forward to seeing him back at Chelsea. But you never know with this team, the way we like spending when nobody's spending, we might go out and get somebody. I think I even heard we could get Pamecano before news came that he might go to Bayern Munich and stuff like that. So I don't know. But I just want Tomori back. Whoever we get in, I just want Tomori back to be in that defense because he's been very, very good.
I agree.
Accepting anything except.
Amart's a fan of Take That's latest song called "I Want Tomori Back for Good." I'm proud of that. It seems like if either a Rudiger or Christensen is going to go, it's probably going to be Christensen because, like you say, Rudiger's definitely fallen is in favor with Tuchel. And it's sad to say, but I have a feeling that Zuma might as well, just because he's just right now, he seems like he's third choice, or hell, even he's third or fourth choice at the moment. I know he's fourth choice. He is fourth choice centre back right now, considering he's been our best performer by Thiago Silva until Tuchel came in. It's sad to say, but I have a feeling that he'll go. He'll get if a good offer comes in. And someone can offer him a starting spot, maybe a top six club or maybe some or another country. I don't see why he wouldn't accept, because he's being like Christensen is being played ahead of him, understandably so, because like Amart said, Christensen's been playing pretty well in the middle of the park. But yeah, I think most of us agree that we think that Zuma's better than Rudiger, yet Rudiger's been playing much more, but maybe it's too soon to make conclusions. But if two centre-backs are going to leave the summer to make space for, say, Mark Guhi and perhaps a new centre-back or Tomori, then I'd expect Zuma and Christensen to leave, sadly for Zuma, but I think that's the way it works now. We can't have five centre backs and make all of them happy, but yeah.
Yeah, but Zuma should be a long term. Zuma should be a long term Chelsea defender. It would be such a shame to let him go. I don't know why. I don't know why or how Rudiger has got this kind of time. Probably he does better in the three. He does better. I think yes, he does better in the three than Zuma. That's why he's probably playing more. But to be honest, I prefer Zuma over Rudiger any day. Rudiger does well, but Zuma is very, very good.
Yeah, agreed. It is a shame, and I do hope that Rudiger is sold before Zuma is. It's just a feeling, and the game time shows, and we maybe if Everton or something come in with a huge money bid, then, and yeah, maybe if we go back to a back four eventually, maybe Zuma comes back into favour. Hopefully that's the case eventually, because we don't want to see Marcus Alonso anyway. So back four it is. But yeah, I think let's join again to the Newcastle game a bit more now.
Yeah.
Sweet. So, I mean, this is an interesting one, more because most of the teams that we aren't playing and the teams around us are. I mean, Man City today beating Tottenham 3-0, Liverpool losing 3-1 to Leicester. It's all the teams or teams around us have dropped points, and say the gap to top four all of a sudden isn't that big. Now it's only, as it stands, we are 1 point off Liverpool with a game in hand, the Newcastle game that we're going to be looking into. So, guys, do you think that's enough motivation for the team to go out there and get a result against a team that Newcastle, well, they're not in the best of form at the moment. They're in a pretty bad... they beat, I think, Villa last game. They did a comeback, I think. But are 17. No, it's Palace. No, Southampton. It was Southampton. Sorry. But yeah, they are 17th at the moment. So do you think it's like this is a foregone conclusion, or do you think it's going to be tricky?
Is this my cue to sing Champions of England again? No. I think honestly, top four looks a lot easier now than it did a few weeks back. And even when Thomas Tuchel was appointed, it looked like it was going to be one of the hardest things to do. But with Liverpool losing three games in a row, Man United drawing their last game, and Leicester in a bit of a not a bad form, but almost in an unstable form at the moment with a loss and two draws in their last five, I think we've already closed the gap, and now we just want to go ahead and if we win against Newcastle, we go fourth in a few more games in. And then we play, I think, the top six, Man United, the top four with Man United, Liverpool, almost back to back in the Premier League. So those two wins, and that would probably take us a long way ahead. And yeah, I think Champions is a bit too far. I think you both are right with your predictions, Man City. But I think Chelsea can 100% mm-hmm. now secure top four. And there's no reason not to, in my opinion, the way we've been playing. Yes, we did kind of struggle against Sheffield, our last Premier League game.
Yes.
Then again as well with Barnsley, but I think Thomas Tuchel has got the experience to know when he needs to switch things around, and I'm 100% sure that when we play Newcastle or the next game against Southampton, we'll be ready to face whatever they bring at us. Hopefully I don't jinx it. Hopefully I don't jinx it like Alex did. But yeah, high hopes from Chelsea now, and these high hopes are there, but I'm also ready for as Tuchel said, get ready for, was it, yeah, we should be ready for disappointment, or we should be ready for I can't exactly remember the words,
to suffer without to the ball. No, that's yeah. No, I was quoting Conte, sorry. Oh. I was joking.
I can't remember the exact quote, but it was somewhere along those lines. So I think, yeah, I'm very hopeful of Chelsea, but at the same time, I'm very careful to not get carried away and start calling Tuchel's head if we lose a game or two in a row.
Yeah. One or two games in a row for who? I'm confused.
I was just saying if we do end up losing a few games and top four doesn't look a lot likely than it is looking right now, I wouldn't go out and to say Tuchel's not the right person. I'll still back him. And
yeah,
I was just saying, yeah, top four is as close to as we can get the top four race to be. So now we just got to make sure that we look at Liverpool's run of games and Man United's run of games, and we just...
Yeah.
Try and just like climb up the table.
Yeah, it's gonna be. I mean, tomorrow we're all going to support West Brom against Man United. But if West Brom can pull off a bit of an upset or even get a draw, even, and we beat Newcastle, then we'll be 4 points, only 4 points off of second, which is kind of crazy. I mean, the competition between us, Leicester, United, And I guess Liverpool, to some extent, it's going to hold up over the next, pretty much until the end of the season. And you're definitely right in the whole, the change in form is possible. Like Liverpool, they've lost their last three games. The champions, they've lost their last three games in a row to, and their last three at off, yeah, their last three at home as well. So anything can happen. And, but I do, like, a, I mean, I flip-flopped through the season in whether we can actually get top four or not. I was so, I gave up on it a couple of weeks ago because I just thought too many good teams ahead of us. But it just shows three wins on the bounce and a draw in the last five, and that's where it gets you. But looking ahead to at least the Newcastle game, Amart, do you see many changes overall to the team that played against Barnsley? Or going to keep the team, other than Kepa, because that's like a foregone conclusion?
The team against Barnsley, I think, yes, there'll be a lot of changes in that team. We might not see Gilmore play. We might not see Christensen. Okay, well, we'll see Christensen start because Thiago Silva has got his head. We might not see Emerson play. We might not see Kepa play. So, yeah, probably. I don't know whether Tammy might get a chance or if Werner. I think Werner right now has a slight injury, but if he's fit, he might probably start with Werner, or he might start with Abraham instead of Giroud. But yeah, this team, this is a game that we have to win. I think you asked if the players need any motivation to get a win here. Yeah, we I think if anything, Liverpool's loss today should be the should be enough motivation for us to go there and win. Are we playing? I don't remember whether it's we're playing
at
away
home.
Or
so
we're playing at
there's
home.
There's no Saint yeah. no Saint okay. James's juju for us. We always
that's
never
true.
Good when we go there. Never.
But I think one thing with Tuchel's team is that we usually get the results, even though the games have been boring. To be fair, I think the only game that we played and dominated like the full 90 will be the Tottenham game, and it's crazy. I think that's one of our easiest games we've played under Tuchel. It was the Tottenham game. We should have scored more than what we did, but we missed a lot of chances. But I think that was our easiest game, and with teams like this, it's very difficult to play against them. I think that's where Lampard suffered a bit. Teams like this were the ones that were giving us most of the problems, and if we're able to beat teams like this, we'll be all right. We'll be okay. And the fact that we are even close to top four, I mean, I was always confident from get go that we would get top four, even when things weren't going well. I still had a feeling we'll get top four because the inconsistencies in the season has been a lot. It has happened a lot. Liverpool falling off. Man United used to be they've been on and off, but it seems like they are on the rise. Leicester too, all of a sudden, they are now on the rise and they are doing well. I think the only team that hasn't really suffered that much is City, and they've done very, very well. I was even checking their form table and everything was just green, and I was like, wow, this is crazy. So they don't look like they are stopping anytime soon. And I think the league is theirs to lose now. But for us, we just have to win against Newcastle. They beat Southampton recently, but they've been pretty poor this season. And I think we need to capitalize on that and just get the 3 points. So it's very, very important for us to go there and win. And yeah, whoever he plays with, I'm confident that we'll get the win. I'm confident. We might not score many goals because we've been struggling to get wins, but we still end up winning. But I think we'll win.
I will say this, all three of us are so confident. I feel like there is an upset in coming.
Yeah, I mean, it's Newcastle's form is very inconsistent. Like, they've beaten Southampton 3-2 recently. Everton, they beat 2-0. But they've also lost to Palace, lost to Leeds, lost to Aston Villa, lost to Arsenal and Sheffield United even. So I think as long as we actually turn up, there shouldn't be too much of a surprise. But if we need the urgency. We'll get into the lineups in a minute, but we definitely need the attackers to be clinical. We need Timo to continue with the way that he's been going over the past couple of games. And also importantly, Newcastle, they're missing their main striker, Callum Wilson. He's out for I think, 6 weeks, I think, with an injury, I think. Or is it a suspension?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's an injury.
I think whenever he's out, they have a really, really bad run of form. So probably it might be in our favour. Might never know.
So that's at least, it's not a positive, but it's a reason to be confident, at least in this game. And it's a home as well. I think we do well against Newcastle at home normally, I think. So, but let's get into the lineups. And I mean, let's skip the goalkeeper because we all know it's going to be Mendy. But I mean, I used to think, oh, maybe when are we ever going to go to a back four? But doesn't seem like it for the short term, at least. But for the back three, I'm going to guess Thiago Silva's still injured, I think is confirmed. So it's going to be, I'm going to guess Rudiger, Christensen, and Aspi. Yeah, Aspi. What are yours?
Same.
Yeah, same, because I don't think we can do any better with anybody else at the moment. Probably Zuma comes in for Rudiger. We might see something different, but I don't think Tuchel would use Zuma as the main central defender. So we might see Rudiger instead of Zuma. So Zuma, Aspi, and then Christensen.
Yeah, sounds good. And then for the wing backs, James and Alonso, or Cho and Alonso, or Cho and Chowell. What's it going to be for you guys? It's tricky.
Hudson-Odoi and Alonso for me, I think.
No, I'll go with Chilwell. I want to see Chilwell. I'll go with Chilwell and Hudson-Odoi. Probably he might go with the way I think we used both Reece James and Hudson-Odoi in the last game, so we might see that again, but not the Barnsley game, the last Premier League game. So we might see that combination again, but for me, I'll prefer we go with Hudson because he did very well in the wing back role than when he was playing behind Werner. So I don't know. So I'll prefer to see him there than but with him and Reece on the right is very, very deadly. So it's confusing. But you know, I'll go with Reece. Reece and Chilwell.
And my only reservation, with Chilwell is just he's in the poor form right now. But Alonso, I mean, other than the wonder goal against Burnley, I think it was, he's just not been that great even in attack. So I want to see Chilwell start as well because he needs to get his confidence back somehow. And yeah, it'll be a good game to play him in. And yeah, don't want to really see Alonso playing much more for Chelsea. So, and for the right, I'll go James because I think Pulisic and Ziyech, they're both out of form when we get to the wingers. So we need Cho in one of those spots. So I'll go James at right wing back. And then for the midfield two, I think it's kind of a foregone conclusion at this point that it's almost definitely going to be Jorginho and Kovacic. Yeah, I think it is. So I'm going to go with, I think, Chilwell and James. Yes, I'm going with Chilwell and James, but it would be because I don't want to see Alonso in the team for much longer, but I recognize he's good at left wing back. But Chilwell needs to get his confidence back anyway. But yeah, also going James because of the choice of front three. Now, Amart, do you think front three, we're going to give Werner a shot, or do you think Pulisic deserves a chance at left wing, or perhaps even Cho?
That's the thing. I don't know whether he's going to go with the, what did he go with the last time? I think he went with the 3-4-2-1, and he has used the 3-4-1-2 as well. But I don't know with this one. I think I'll prefer him to go with the 3-4-1-2, and play with Cho is already my Cho. Reece is already my right back. So probably Mount behind Werner and Hudson-Odoi. So that's the three I'll go with.
Yeah, I'm going to go same, I think. And Mohammed, what are you going to go with?
this would be the midfielders.
No, the front three.
Oh, sorry, I just got.
Have I done a Mohammed? I've done a Mohammed, haven't I?
Yeah, you skipped.
I skipped him.
That's why I was
skipped the midfield.
That's what now, viewers. I'm sorry, but we essentially had a bit of a break where, yeah, Amart's kind of traveled through different dimensions, and it looks like he's gone now. But he's back. He's back on his little adventure. But yes, I think we forgot to talk about the midfielders. But I'm gonna go. Actually, yeah, let's do that. Let's finish with the front three, and then we'll go back to the midfielders. So. Yeah, I'm going to go agree with Amart. And Mohammed, what's your front three before we go back to the mids?
I think I'll go with Pulisic. That's the thing. Callum Hudson-Odoi is going to start. And then again, I think Pulisic and Werner probably for me.
Oof, he's dropping Mason Mount. His followers weren't like that.
I think Werner and Callum and Sodor and Mount. I think, yeah, sorry, Pulisic. Yeah, no.
Right.
Before I get hurt.
Is Pulisic, are you going to start Pulisic or not? No, so I think
Mount and Pulisic swap. Last minute.
All right. Yeah, it's like, I would like to see, ideally I want to see a Werner Pulisic Hudson-Odoi, but at the moment it just seems like Pulisic's just not in great form, and this result is really important to get ourselves up the table. So we've kind of united on that. But to get to the, let's go back to the midfield. And I can't remember if I said or not, but I want to stick to what's worked and go with Jorginho and Kovacic. But I understand Mohammed and Amart, you probably have different feelings. So Mohammed, what are you going
with? Kovacic and Jorginho for me. They've been playing well. And then Kante and Gilmore, as I said, they were good at the weekend. They were good against Barnsley, but I don't think they're ready for Newcastle. And why interfere with the midfield that's already been working? So I think that's my midfield there.
And Amart, what's yours?
Yeah, I think I'll also go with. I'll not go with Jorginho. I'll go with Kovacic and Kante. Nearly. I know they've been doing well. I know their chemistry has been good and all that, but I don't know. I still don't trust Jorginho, and I felt like even our last game that he scored a penalty or so, but even in that game he really wasn't the best. So I'll go with Kante. I don't want us to leave Kante out. Kante has to be involved in this team one way or the other this season. I think he is more important to the team, or he offers more to the team than Jorginho. But definitely Kovacic next to him.
Yeah, it's fair enough. I mean, we've got to see. Yeah, Kante is clear that Kante is one of Tuchel's favourite players. So wouldn't be surprised to see Kante back in there for Jorginho, considering how highly it's been made evident that I think Tuchel did an interview where he talked about the importance of Kovacic, and Kovacic has been playing pretty well, probably the best non-academy player this season. So, yeah, I think that that completes our lineup. And any other passing remarks for the Newcastle game? Other than no pressure on us, but we have to win.
No, I think we can do this. Just got to go in there and just, you know, kill the game quickly. Which we really haven't been able to do, but I guess just if we start off with intensity and get an early goal, then we can really put pressure on Newcastle and eventually get the 3 points in top four, hopefully.
Yeah, I definitely want to see an improvement in terms of finishing. Like, I think it's probably one of the reasons why we haven't been able to kill games. Amart, do you think this is going to be the time where we see Werner finally get his break, his Premier League?
I mean, he better score, because for my FPL sake, I've had him for so long, and he has disappointed me time and time and time again. And this season, this week, I did something, and I really hope he scores, because I took him out and brought Kane in, and I realized that, you know, they are playing against Man City, and they're playing against a top team or something. Like, I've forgotten who it was, but Venom. I just felt like Venom might do well in this game, so I took Kane out again and I brought Venom in, and I got a -4 points. So I'm really, really hoping he does well this time, because I just have this feeling that he might do well this time. If he doesn't score in this, he's out of my team. I've had him for a long time. So sorry for going to the Fantasy League aspect, but I just think he's been doing well. He's been doing very, very well. And I feel like it's high time he starts scoring. And I know he will start scoring well. Even if he doesn't score, like his contribution to the game has improved a lot. So if he can continue that, I think we would be able to beat Newcastle. That is if he starts, fine. But if he doesn't start, then whoever starts will also do well for us in attack.
Agreed. Yeah, it's we definitely want to see some better finishing in this game at least, and just to not have to survive the game and in the last 15 minutes suffer like we did against Barnsley and just hope that we don't concede. But another clean sheet would be good to kind of for Mendy particularly to keep up the race for the Golden Glove. I think I think Edison's on 13. I think
Martinez is,
and Mendy's on. Yeah, Martinez I think might be ahead of Mendy.
In clean sheets, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think Man City are top with 14, then Chelsea have 10, Villa have 12. So, yeah, Martinez has more than Mendy at the moment. But, yeah, would be a good one to get against Newcastle. It's definitely a viable game to get a clean sheet in. But I think more important, I mean, for me, I would rather have Werner go and score one or two than get the clean sheet, personally. He really needs that. Like, he's been playing really well, to be fair, recently. But just want him to, he really needs to score. He really needs to score in the Premier League. It's going to be, if he doesn't, it'll be 15 games in the Premier League without scoring. So it's got to happen one way or another eventually. And if there's no Jorginho, then surely he'll be on penalties. So he can win them and take them. So that would be good. Any other remarks for the Newcastle game?
No, I think that's all.
Not really. I just want us to win. We have to win because we have to capitalize on the fact that Liverpool are doing so bad. So and it's weird. I looked at the table and if we win, and I think Everton is the team behind us, right? I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But if they also win, it means that they would be. Is it Everton or West? I think there's a team behind us before Everton. Whoever it is, like the team
West
behind
Ham. West Ham.
Yeah. So if West Ham also wins, which means Liverpool might finish the week on sit. It's crazy.
You know, what's even more crazy is that if Everton managed to win, so I think Everton play twice. They have the game in hand where they play against Man City and they play against Fulham.
Yeah.
So if they beat if Everton beat Fulham tomorrow and then somehow might maybe manage to draw against Man City, then they'll go above Liverpool as well. So Liverpool could end up seventh by in a couple of days, which is quite interesting. But yeah, looking forward to see how the table is going to look like in a couple of days once we get a Chelsea win, or hopefully we get a Chelsea win. But yeah, I think that's all we've got in time for in this podcast. I'm quite impressed that we've probably taken, I think it's about an hour now. We've had we had some technical issues, so we've had to split it up a bit. So we're not really sure if this has been an hour long, but if you are still listening right now, thank you very much for doing so. And should have said this at the start as well, but if you do like what we do, I would definitely really appreciate if you did give us a like or a subscribe. It just shows some appreciation for the huge amount of effort that goes into making these. So, but thank you very much for listening if you are at the end, and we'll see you in the next podcast where we'll review the Newcastle game and look forward to Southampton. And so thank you very much for both my co-hosts for tonight. Mohammed, I'm impressed that you've managed to be here more than not being here. So thank you very much. And Amart for being here as well. And being Amart as well for being here as usual. Thank you very much, guys. And we'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.